I often just happen to see her, and it pleases me to see her this way, because this is how we form a relation that won't cause anyone pain if it breaks. Distinct from both body and soul, she is a realization of beauty, and I am a special point of view which makes that beauty unique. For as long as I recognize her, I live in the impassioned awareness of the artist, spellbound. When I avert my face, her disappearance becomes the emptiness of a dream. Who is she? She could be anybody, but more important than this, what is she to me? Maybe no one, but I can't say that, because her being something to me, or to others through me, depends less on her than it does on myself. Her appearance owes nothing to my vision. Still, by virtue of this relation, I am somehow so helpless that I cannot deny the mere fact of seeing her. I know that this beauty can show up anytime, anywhere, and again make the idea that she means nothing to me meaningless in a new way. Because I first of all accepted this acquaintance with her beauty, I have no desire to know all the things that are unrelated to it. Whatever else she is other than this beauty does not reassure me. It worries me. To know anything else may mean comprehending her in a way that makes it necessary to distort myself. I may not believe in God or Satan, but I can still get caught between godliness and devilry. Or she might come across not as beauty, but as someone else's need, in which my aesthetic devotion gets reduced to just being an awkward obstacle. It is possible, too, that as soon as she gets to know me, she acknowledges me in a strange way, completely disregarding that vision of mine which makes her unique. It is possible that a simple relation between us breaks, and in its place we get tangled up in all those stupidities and crudities that are no more important than the weather being good or bad. Her knowing me too could ruin that whole situation, which I have so tastefully and fondly kept saved in the form of a monologue away from the conversations of people. To understand myself through her eyes, if not downright fatal, could still be quite painful. Whether she appreciates someone by seeing or by understanding him is a fundamental question from which I begin life, not just the story of her beauty. Which is why I fear that she might just meet me in an unforeseen way and, keeping a polite distance, reenact some hackneyed performance in the quotidian half-dead language of consciousness, being, nothingness, and leave me wandering the streets. Words might form out of her speech but no meaning, perhaps leaving me alone in my quest for those meanings without which neither can beauty be established, nor any important relation to it. As usual, today too, perhaps she wasn't satisfied at merely being seen. Taking that moment to be uninspired, as always, she kept talking about other people to other people, while I kept talking about my views to myself. It seemed she saw no relation between thinking and speaking. Or, if she did think, it was only what had already been thought and spoken and which could safely be applied to any person, circumstance, or event. Whether someone else thought for her or about her, in spite of this, she is and will remain the true realization of beauty. It's not too hard to be happy. To be pleasant, however, is a different kind of responsibility. Just as being beautiful and being discerning are two different truths, which are perhaps forced to live apart from one another. Which is why whenever I sink into thought's subtleties, those unaccustomed to thinking explain that for something as coarse as happiness, subtle thinking is not only uncalled for, but deadly. Happiness, in their view, is an open green field which one can start grazing on from any direction and stop wherever one pleases. And he who drifts hungry and thirsty in life's lush green valleys, if not an ass, is not happy either. She whom I think of, even if I get her without thinking, of what use would she be to me? After all, I am one who thinks on himself and thinks on beauty, but is proved false in trying to get anything. Because getting also means preparing oneself for all of those things which are neither beauty nor thought, but merely about each one's own position, which is either acceptable to both sides or wrong from both sides. And therefore, it is neither able to bring us closer together to each other, nor take us far from each other. I am aware that the more I strengthen my thoughts and words, people will understand me less or wrongly by that same degree. When we got introduced, she joined both her hands into a namaskar, which meant that I should reciprocate in exactly the same way, whether I agreed with that practice or not. I found I was tied to that tradition in such a way that I could not even greet back the way I really wished. That is, I could not even do as much as take her folded hands into my own. Giving her no reply at all would have been more satisfying for me, but I was discovering that I hadn't even been allowed this much freedom. And while understanding all of this, still felt that being compelled to answer in any one way would be insulting. Maybe she looked at me somewhat differently, pondered, and then struck upon a solution for herself. This is my husband. And who am I to object? Even if there were anything objectionable to this, duty was to accept it quietly in such circumstances. And so, from my side, I promptly divided her beauty up into four parts and sacrificed three parts for her husband forevermore. The fourth part kept flailing about in my imagination for some time, like a severed head after the sacrifice. From my being there, a triangle had been formed based on me. I thought, could a story be formed too? After many days, she met me again today. A terrible cold had overwhelmed her poor head, and her nose was running. I thought, if she were made of stone, then she would be free from this suffering. Then too she would be beautiful, and would belong to no one. She would be barren. She, who wouldn't be there for anyone, wouldn't be there for her husband either. What if all men were of one kind? What if all women were of one kind? And what if life was a huge, lush green pasture? Red flowers are nothing special, but they were there in her hair. It was strange for her to be like those flowers, sometimes on her own, sometimes in someone's imagination. Fortunate are those who know the utility of beauty. Unfortunate is he who wonders what to do with so much of it. On two sides of an imaginary line are parallel distances. Even if this line were to be erased, the distances don't go. They become one on one side of the line. What if two lines of a triangle were removed? How fearsome was that form which could instill in a person a desire beyond his grasp. Whosoever came in contact with that beauty was destroyed. That blazing beauty which needed the infinity of the sky to shine, the trail of a comet to carpet her steps, who, when she descended upon the earth, reduced the jungles to ash like a wildfire. Helen. That beauty which the old Homer feared to touch. Just a glimpse from afar, that was all. And such a glimpse that keeps literature aglow to this day. A femme fatale who could not only incite the sublime in men, but also some intemperance in him. Lust, wrath, violence, envy, greed. Such that his destiny changed. That day, she too was in that place where I was almost not. From amidst the cigarette smoke, the commotion, the boisterous music, clinking glasses of alcohol and stumbling, meaningless conversations, she found a brief pause somewhere. You, she asked, what world are you lost in?
Yes, me.
Perhaps in the world of fish, like a diver from the outside world in search of some lost pearl. Have you found it? Maybe the oyster's shell, looking at her attentively. But I don't know if there is a precious pearl inside it, or only some insect. Why don't you check when it's there in your hand? Is it? I thought I only saw it out of reach. Anyway, to check it, I would need to take it out of the water and into the light. Is the light here not enough? The light here isn't real. It's only for fake pearls. For real pearls, you need real light. The light of the sun or the moon. The moon, where is there? On the banks of the ocean,
on the sands. There is another world too, apart from this suffocating, fictitious one, where one can find the open sky, gentle wind, and moonlight purifying the heart with happiness through and through. You must have surely read about it in the books. Can you unravel the meaning of that world, which is unraveled in poems? But the question is, can everyone unravel it? Suddenly, in a stumbling voice, her husband announced without context, "She is not an open book. She is my private diary. Reading her will be a mistake." I did not know that fourth man who was outside of the triangle, but I knew of that danger which could one day appear because of that fourth. Then one day he appeared and said without preamble, "She wants to meet you." Eyeing that fourth with evident suspicion, I asked, "What for?" "What for? Don't you want to meet her? Don't you want her?" He dropped this heavy question on me very heartlessly and watched with folded arms how I composed myself around his question. Undoubtedly, he was dangerous. For the first time, I realized how ancient his face could be, maybe thousands of years old, a face I had seen before, in fact, frequently seen before, vicious and vulpine, like some fanged beast or mythic demon, in search of the earliest chance to strike and bring a weak prey into his claws. Like always, now too, I could have gathered my wits and moved ahead, but the pall of a strange magic went on spreading over me and summoning me against my will towards that inauspicious man. "Why would you do all this for me?" "Because I've taken an interest in you and in your soul. When can I see her?" "Within the hour." And within the hour, she was found out from somewhere and presented before me. All I could do was keep staring, stunned, just like Dr. Faust. I wanted her to speak first, but she kept standing silently, helplessly. I suddenly kissed her. She locked her eyes onto mine boldly. Had she been brought here by force? Could she belong to anyone? Did that fourth have designs on her soul as well? Standing completely naked before the mirror, she kept looking at herself attentively, but not with her eyes. Instead, through three principal visions, and then through countless unknown visions. To see oneself in this manner was to see others in a special way. She covered her face with both her hands. She only kept peeking at her body from between two fingers. This slight obstruction made her even more attractive. Suddenly, she said, "Are you familiar with the story of woman?" "Which story?" I asked in some confusion. "Adam and Eve?" "No, that was just the beginning of the story. Let me tell you the next one." And, puncturing two holes in a black scarf for her eyes, she wrapped it around her face. Then, in this same manner, she made two big holes in a shirt where her breasts should have been and pulled it over her head. Finally, she made one hole in the front of her pants. In the dim light, the blackness of her clothing began to disappear, but the unconcealed parts gleamed even more clearly. She colored them with the red of her lipstick. What do you mean? It embarrasses me to tell this story, which is why I covered myself. I did not cover the parts that are not ashamed. The next story will surely go somewhat like this. In the beginning, woman was naked. She has again become almost naked. She will become completely naked. But even this will not be enough. So soon, she will again start to put on clothes, until her entire body is covered up, except for those parts which should stay covered. Do you know what will happen next? I do, I said torpidly. Your husband will go insane. He will gather hordes of people to surround my house and set fire to it. When we both slip out of the house like mice and flee, he will challenge and kill me or leave me wounded. He will also want to kill you, but your beauty will save you. For the poems and the stories.